So, as Dr. Kohler so eloquently said, we're going to talk today about the management of pediatric status epilepticus. We're going to go through a short case and talk about some new practice rec well, they were new 5 years ago, new practice recommendations that the Neurocritical Care Society had passed down for pediatric management of this, and some things that we've done here at UW to help shore up our management, and especially in our emergency room and our inpatient care settings. So I have no financial disclosures to tell you guys about, neither does anyone in this room or other rooms elsewhere. The practice recommendations that, and really the objectives that we like to hammer home today, are that your major goals of therapy for status epilepticus are as follows. The first thing you want to do is to stop the seizure as soon as you possibly can. Tying in with that is the rapid recognition and subsequent treatment of any reversible causes that you can find in the short term. The next item would be consistent and rapid anti-epileptic drug, anti-seizure medication administration with a global goal, with an overarching goal of achieving at least three different anti-epileptic drugs in the first 60 minutes of seizure. And of course, just as with everything else, every time we're seeing a patient in any clinical setting, you want to maintain adequate airway, breathing, and circulation through the course of their seizure, as well as the course of your treatment. So we have a case. This is a generic case of a 5-year-old male who came into the ED after she started seizing at home about 10 minutes ago. Her parents are lucky and live very close to the hospital. So, as soon as she started having altered mental status and convulsions at her house, they threw her in the car safely, of course, and brought her to the emergency department. She's a healthy girl. She's had 4 days of vomiting and diarrhea. She hasn't really eaten very much at all, but her parents say that she's been keeping down fluids all right. And of course, just as most pediatric parents will tell you, she has been acting, quote, lethargic all week. It's a very loaded word for us in the clinical setting. And it has a lot of implications for children who are seizing, of course. She has never been hospitalized and she's not on any medications. She has no known allergies. So let's talk about what exactly is happening here. So she, by dint of her 10 minutes of seizure activity, she qualifies for the new definition of status epilepticus, according to the rules that the Neurocritical Care Society passed in 2012. That definition is 5 minutes or more of continuous clinical or electrographic, and that's important, seizure activity. So the other definition that they passed was to call recurrent seizure activity without return to the baseline mental status between seizures. So you have a 2-minute seizure, you stop having convulsions, but you're not quite arousable and you're still profoundly altered, and then 5 minutes later, you have another 2-minute seizure, even though that's not adding up to 5 minutes or more of continuous convulsive seizure activity, that still qualifies as status epilepticus by these new guidelines. The new definition for refractory status epilepticus is not a time-based definition any longer. That is now being called status epilepticus that does not respond to standard treatment regimens. So, in other words, you've given your benzodiazepines, you've given a second type of anti-seizure medication, and the patient is still seizing. By definition now, that patient qualifies as refractory status. The fact that these definitions have changed from the way they used to be before 2012 is really important because the old definition said that you could have continuous seizure activity for 30 minutes before you would qualify as having status epilepticus, and that's a lot longer, as you can see, from the 5-minute definition that we see now. The reason why this changed and the reason why this is so important is because that seizure activity, as it continues, really causes that tissue environment in the brain to use up a lot of oxygen, use up a lot of substrate, including glucose in the brain, which really just engenders more irritability, more inflammation in the brain tissue, which really just begets more seizure. So seizure causes more seizure, which causes more seizure. And the other important thing that we've more recently realized is that the longer a seizure goes on, the more difficult it is to treat. So, if you've been having a seizure for 5 minutes or longer, the likelihood that that seizure is going to spontaneously stop on its own becomes less and less as each minute passes. So, we really started to recognize that status epilepticus lasting a 5-minute period or longer constitutes a medical emergency. And it really does require three simultaneous actions as soon as it's recognized, which, just as I mentioned in the beginning, as always, is the stabilization and support of your airway, breathing, and circulation. You need to rapidly identify reversible causes of seizure and treat those as you can. And then you need to administer anti-seizure medications as soon as you can. So because there's a lot of work that goes into the first couple few minutes of recognizing status epilepticus, and because some of the things that we had noticed in the literature, which I'll talk about in a moment, we at UW had thought that this would be a perfect example of something that would benefit from a clinical pathway. A clinical pathway is meant to provide practitioners at the bedside, be they EMTs or nurse practitioners or MDs, pediatric residents on the general care floors, an algorithm and a pathway for them to go from step to step without having to do too much, to think too much about whether their doses are correct or the timing is correct. In this way, we can decrease unintended variability in the delivery of care and minimize delays in the delivery of that care. We also wanted to provide evidence-based recommendations for people that so that they didn't feel like they were kind of doing the best they possibly could in that situation. So the reason why we recognized that this was important was because of a couple of studies really bring this to the fore. The first one is a study in 2008. It was done in Australia, and they looked at a couple of their different emergency departments. And what they had recognized was that 25% of the patients that presented to the emergency department had to wait 34 minutes or more to get a second anti-epileptic drug administered to that patient, which is actually twice, almost twice as long as the current recommendations would allow. So actually some patients, a quarter of those patients were waiting even longer than that 36-minute window. And the other reason that we had thought this would be an important thing to target was another study in 2008 that said that folks who were administering benzodiazepine to patients in emergency rooms, actually in the US this time, we're doing so outside of what the clinical practice guidelines would recommend about a quarter of the time. So we thought this would be a good tool for people here at our institution to start to use. And here it is. We're going to go through this in detail as we go through the other details of our case. But this is to give you an idea of, for you guys to know of just how a person can walk through the pathway, know which medications they're meant to give and when and by which route, and what to do to troubleshoot if you don't have, say, the IV access that you need. If your patient's starting to have trouble, if your patient has other comorbidities that might not make it as useful for you to use the certain medications that we have listed here. This is available on the UW Health UConnect website, if anyone is interested in taking a look at that later. So for our purposes, for our patient, and for all patients really who present with seizure onset, your treatment timeline is going to be as follows. The first 5 minutes, as I mentioned, are going to be pretty busy. As your patient is presenting in the emergency department or in the general care floors, you want to know what time the seizure started so that you know exactly how far down the pathway you are with that patient. So you know the time just like you would with a patient who's resting on the floor or otherwise. Your clock starts the second that patient hits the door or the second those convulsions start. Step two is, as always, to support airway breathing and circulation. So is your patient protecting his airway? Is your patient doing an adequate job of breathing? Do you hear breath sounds bilaterally? Are they keep maintaining their oxygen levels? Are they supporting their own ventilation adequately? If they're not doing those things, then you're going to be moving forward with protecting that patient's airway and placing a breathing tube earlier on in the pathway than not. You also want to know, of course, does your patient have a pulse? Do they have a perfusing rhythm? Is that rhythm sinus? Do they have an adequate blood pressure? Is your blood pressure so high that perhaps that's the cause of their seizure? So these are the things you're going to find out within the first couple few seconds of meeting that patient. In order to do that, of course, you're going to need to apply your monitoring devices. This is continuous EKG monitoring, pulse oximetry, and then you want a frequent blood pressure monitor on the order of every 5 minutes. If your patient is hypoxemic, then you're going to want to apply a high oxygen delivery device, so a non-rebreather or even bag mask ventilation. Know, however, that if unless they have an element of lung disease, then the reason that they're hypoxemic is probably that they're hypoventilating, which again brings you back to the first thing in your pathway of supporting your ABCs. If they're hypoxemic because they're hypoventilating, then you need to do what you can to help that patient blow down their CO2. So back to our patient. So these are her vital signs when she arrives. You can see that she is in sinus tachycardia, a heart rate of 150. She does have a blood pressure. It is a little high, but it certainly doesn't look like it's high enough to constitute malignant hypertension. She is tachypneic with a respiratory rate of 32, and she's hypoxemic with a SAD of 93%. She's a little bit febrile. Her weight's 20 kilos, which is about appropriate for a 5-year-old. Her breath sounds are coarse and shallow, but she does have air entry bilaterally. Her pulses are about 1 plus, certainly not hugely generous, and her cap refill is delayed at 4 seconds. Her skin is clammy, she's cold to the elbows and knees, and of course you notice generalized convulsions. Her pupils are 4 millimeters, a bit big, and they are reactive briskly bilaterally. And this would have been something that would have popped up magically by the magic of PowerPoint and animations, but now that you already know, we'll just go through it. So your crack nurse, who's awesome, noticed when the seizing patient came in the door that she was seizing and heard that she'd been seizing for 10 minutes, so said, "Hey, let's go get some midazolam from our Pyxis or Echidos, whatever it is we have here in our emergency department. We're going to give a non-invasive route of midazolam. We're going to give midazolam 4 milligrams intranasally because my patient already qualifies for status epilepticus, and she's been seizing for 10 minutes already. So the earlier we get benzodiazepine into her, the better off she'll be." She also, because she's such an excellent nurse, grabbed a point of care glucose and AccuCheck, and it was 29. So now we could have a source for our seizure. We could also have the cause of continued seizures because, like we mentioned earlier, seizures are a very metabolically active occurrence, and she could also just have been malnourished to begin with because of her ongoing illness, and now her pure glucose is low because of her seizure. But regardless, you're going to want to do something about that. So this brings us back to our treatment timeline. We have this saying here on our emergency department, ABCs, airway breathing circulation, and don't ever forget the glucose, DEFG. That's going to be your next thing that you get right after checking your airway breathing circulation. That's going to be really difficult to correct without IV or IO access. So that's going to be your next course of action. As you're getting your IV access, you're going to want to be collecting your critical labs, especially with consideration to the things that you can correct rapidly, including your electrolytes. So pay special attention to sodium, to magnesium, to calcium. Consider a CVC. If your patient has epilepsy at baseline and is on anti-epileptic drugs, consider collecting those drug levels, as that might be a source for their ongoing seizure. And then, depending on your situation, depending on how long the patient's been seizing, what their comorbidities are, consider the rest of these things here. As these might be a source for part of your differential diagnosis. You want to do a targeted H&P and a targeted neuro exam because your differential diagnosis for seizure is pretty broad. So, you know, has this patient been in a car accident and that's the reason why they're seizing? Do they have ongoing fevers and have they been irritable at home? Have they had poor PO intake? Do they have headaches over the last couple of weeks and they're increasing in intensity and they have a mass occupying lesion or hydrocephalus? Are they intensely jaundiced, and do they have petechiae everywhere? Are they bleeding in their head? Do they have ongoing congenital heart disease or heart failure, and the reason why they're seizing is because they've been progressively more hypoxemic, either because of their heart disease or because of their some terrible pneumonia that they've developed? Could they possibly have ingested something? So that's a very broad differential, but you can really drill down into narrowing that pretty quickly with your targeted H&P. And then your neuro exam isn't, of course, going to be asking the patient to walk around or do a Romberg or test their auditory acuity. No, it's going to be, if your patient's an infant, then feel their fontanelle, look at everybody's pupils. If there is some sort of focal lesion intracranially, then seizures tend to cause eye deviation away from the focus of that tumor or bleed. And then of course, are these convulsions generalized or are they more focused? Are they localized to one side of the body and not the other? So that's what that means. So, after 5 and 10 minutes of seizure, you're going to be giving a benzodiazepine. First, you're going to correct what you possibly can. So our patient, for example, you're going to give that patient IV dextrose. At the 5-minute mark of seizure, you're going to give a benzodiazepine. And if that patient's still seizing after 10 minutes, you give a second benzodiazepine. So because the GABAergic receptors and the receptors that you're actually targeting by giving a benzodiazepine they involute into the neuron as seizures continue, if your patient's already received 2 doses of benzodiazepine, those receptors aren't going to be there any longer for that benzo to really be as effective. So if your patient's gotten 2 doses of BZD before they got to the hospital, maybe move on to other things at that point. But otherwise, your first course of action and your second course of action is going to be lorazepam 0.1 milligram per kilo IV with a max dose of 4 milligrams. So back to our patient. She's now been in the ER for 5 minutes. You've done all the right things by positioning her head, making sure that her airway is nice and open in a good sniffing position. She's gotten an IV. You're going to give her dextrose solution because that seems like, if it wasn't the cause of her seizure, it's certainly not helping. Then you're going to give her, after she's been seizing for 5 minutes after her first midazolam dose when she first arrived, you're going to give her 2 milligrams of lorazepam, which is 0.1 per kilo. And glory be, her convulsions stop after she's been seizing for a total of 15 minutes. And now her vital signs look like they're returning to normal. her cap refill still is crappy, so you're gonna give her 20 mils per kilo of normal saline. And lo and behold, she starts opening her eyes. She's allowed to have a postictal period for about 10 minutes until you start wondering whether or not she's still having non-convulsive status underneath. But as long as she's making progress in that direction, you can feel good about yourself for doing excellent patient care. Great job. So what if you don't have IV or IO access? Well, just as our patient didn't have that when she arrived in the emergency room, we have a couple different options to give either IM, buccal, intranasal, midazolam, or rectal diazepam. And the doses are listed both here and in our clinical pathway that we had written for the hospital some time ago. Another important point, after you give your second dose of benzodiazepine, you want to let your pharmacy know that your patient is still seizing and they're going to have to prepare the third anti-seizure medication so that you can be ready to administer it if your patient's still seizing at 20 minutes. The medication that you're going to be reaching for in most cases at the 20-minute mark of seizure is phosphenytoin. This is a drug of choice for most patients, although because of its arrhythmogenic properties, it can prolong QTC. If your patient has heart disease or has rhythm disease, if your patient's also perhaps on phenytoin at home because of his or her epilepsy, the next choice that you want to reach for is phenobarbital in most cases. It's also the first drug of choice for neonatal status epilepticus. It does a better job in breaking febrile status epilepticus. These are certain considerations that you can make in that setting. Because these medications are sedating, especially with regard to phenobarbital, causes pretty significant respiratory depression, also causes circulatory depression and hypotension. You always want to remember that you're supporting your airway breathing and circulation by side effect of seizure and by side effect of the medications that you're giving. So if your patient doesn't have an airway already, this is the point where he or she should. If your patient is still seizing after 30 or 60 minutes, here are some other medication options that you can reach for. Phenobarbital, if you haven't given it as your urgent therapy medication. Keppra is a good medication for, not necessarily for stopping convulsions in the short term, but our neurologists like to recommend that if you, quote, get it on board early, then that can have better implications for you in the next couple of days. Valparate is another medication that you can use, but it's contraindicated in patients under 2, and it also causes hepatotoxicity, so use that with care for those patients with liver disease. At this point, if your patient's still seizing, you're probably talking with either a pediatric neurologist or a neurologist. There are also repeat doses of the previous medications that you can give to increase the drug serum level of those meds. And the goal is to, like I had mentioned in the very beginning, deliver 3 of these medications before the 60-minute mark. The reason why that's important is because, again, another study looked at folks who had if they were still seizing after receiving 2 anti-epileptic drugs, and they were meant to receive a 3rd anti-epileptic drug. If they received that 3rd anti-epileptic drug after the 1-hour mark, they were 22% likely to have their seizures stop at that point. But kids who'd received a 3rd anti-epileptic drug within that 60-minute mark, 100% of them had stopped seizing. So that's really why it's important to really be on the ball with making sure that you're doing a good job with remembering your benzos, your phosphenytoin, and your phenobarb. And 60 minutes might seem a bit faster than what we had been doing previously, but we'd also, now we're recognizing that seizures aren't good for you to keep having after that 5-minute mark. So after you've done all the right things and your patient's no longer seizing, of course they're going to be admitted and have monitoring of ABCs in support of the same. You're going to want to correct and follow up all of your hypoglycemic labs and your electrolyte disturbances. And that's all she wrote. Thank you all for your apt attention, rapt attention.